says, my question is about 5 second power versus FTP. My FTP is currently 251 watts, putting me at about 3.87 watts per kilogram, which I'm happy about, and continue to chase 4 watts per kilogram. Way to go so far, Keith. That's awesome. My 5 second power, however, is limited to about 650 watts, and it seems like relative to my FTP, I should be able to put out close to 1,000 watts. I bet you've been looking at the power chart from Coggin. I bet you have, if you're looking at this assumption here. I could be wrong, but it says, I lift 2 to 3 times a week on the same days as TrainerRoad workouts. I weigh 143 pounds and can squat 5x5 reps of 160 pounds and deadlift 5x5 at 175 pounds. Not overly pushing myself in this area as it is secondary to cycling performance. So I don't feel like my absolute leg strength is a limiter. So what actually is limiting my 5 second power? And then Keith mentions a very important detail. He says, I come from a mountain biking background and have moved into triathlon recently. And I would love to hear any thoughts on how I can improve. So thanks a lot from Keith. So maybe we can start off. I know I shifted the order here, Amber, so forgive me on this one, but maybe we can start off with your points first, and then that can take us through the rest of this one and how we want to answer this.
Yeah, I was just going to say there is the Coggin power chart, and I know that that's a reference point for a lot of people, but the fact of the matter is the relationship between your power curve and your FTP is not fixed. So how your 5 second power compares to your FTP is going to have a lot more to do with how much you train your explosive power than what your FTP is. And part of that is because the ability to produce short power in short bursts, it's highly technique dependent. It's not just about your aerobic fitness or your absolute leg strength. It's hard to make that kind of, it's not just about power production. It's about how fast you can spin the pedals, how efficient you are, how much you're actually able to get out of that drivetrain, how high you can get your cadence. And all of those things are highly, highly technique dependent that require specific training. So yes, there is a relationship between these power zones, but it's not a linear one. So again, like you'll get, if you're really, really worried about your 5 second power, you need to train it. But if that's not necessarily something that's going to serve you in your goal events, then, you know, if your 5 second power isn't where you think it should be, maybe that's okay because you're focusing your efforts on training the things that are going to be more relevant for you.
Mm. This is so with sprinting, like you just mentioned, and actually a good point to say once again, we've said this very frequently as of late, but you're not good at what you don't do. You get better at what you do. So, and with sprinting in particular, there's so much technique at play that you can like really just try to put out a lot of watts for a long time. But if you aren't trying to accomplish technique goals, then you're probably not going to be making the progress that you should be making, right? Because so much of it, like you just said, Amber, has to do with technique. And that just takes so much practice. And I think that, so I noticed, like I just tried to do a couple sprints in my workout 2 days ago. And I just felt so, I was like wobbly all over the place, wonky, like felt terrible because I haven't done them in a long time. So this isn't like a thing where like you can touch up your sprint. I don't know. Maybe Justin Williams can just like put out 1800 watts off the couch after a year off. I don't know. Probably can.
But that's because of how many years before that year off that he trained this?
Yes.
Yeah. He said he's done like 10,000 sprints plus or something like that.
Yeah.
It was.
Yeah.
Insane. Yeah.
So in that case, like you may have built something up, but for most of us average people, we have to practice them in close proximity to when we're actually measuring them. Like you, if you really want to measure your sprint power, you should be spending time leading up to that, working on your sprints. So technique is just like so important. And Nate, that's the sprinting video that we have on our YouTube channel that we did with you. That was one of the intents with this, right?
Yes, but Keith, you are a track and this is like a track cyclist complaining about not being able to manual. Like there is, you will never sprint on the bike as a triathlete ever. And if you do, you should not be doing it. This is not in your wheelhouse and not something you need to worry about. If you do decide to do road racing or crits or maybe cross, really even mountain bike racing, it's very rare that you need to sprint. And it's probably better just to work on skills and just overall power. It's really the sprints I think happen at the very, very top end where there's tactical races where they all hang together via drafts and all that sort of stuff. Anyways, my issue, yes, I don't sprint very often. My technique is so bad that out of the saddle, I put out like 100 more watts than in the saddle, which is it's good that I might have a higher end in there, but that's not very common that you only gain 100 more watts when you've, when you're out of the saddle. And if you watch that sprinting video, I am like a fish. I'm loosey-goosey in the tail. So there's all this power that, that leaves.
That's a good shoulder roll there, Nate. That was good.
I can't wait until Amber said something about, it's not about putting out the max amount of torque at 1 second, but the thought of how fast can you spin your cadence up? And I want to be able to retrain my brain into thinking about just accelerating the pedals rather than I have this kind of thing where it's a 1 second max torque that I really aim for. With a pull and a push, a pull with my arm and a push with my leg. I'm hoping that will give me extra power, Amber. But Keith, like, bro, just don't worry about it.
Mm-hmm. We've covered the, so we have that sprinting video where we cover this, but one thing I've learned in particular from that video is I can tell somebody like the technique that I use and use it in my words, and that may not resonate with another person. They may hear it differently from another person and it clicks because it's once again, when we're trying to use words to describe these physical movements that are so much tied in with like intuition and feel, it's really tough to be able to do it. Ivy, if I was asking you, like, Ivy, how do I sprint? Like, what are the main physical or technique things that you would focus on? Because there's a lot that you could tell me, but what were the main things that you would say to focus on with technique?
Sure. I think I should keep it pretty simple because we do cover like a lot of that, like pushing and pulling and arm and leg motion, like in the sprinting 101 videos. I think the things that helped sprinting really click for me, where I saw the most significant gain in like speed and performance and like smoothness and making it feel natural, was my posture and position. And for me, all those push and pull things didn't matter and weren't effective unless I was super far in front of the bike and super low. So like face and chin above, as in like beyond and low, like pretty freaking near to my stem. Like that kind of mechanics of posture and position makes all of those pushing and pulling things and the movement of the bike feel natural and really click for me. And that's a thing to practice and train, and requires a lot of trunk strength and is hard to do at like low speed and like, hard to do at a high cadence when you're learning it. Yeah, I guess, does that make sense? It's hard to describe. Yeah.
That sounds pretty close to a super tuck. I don't know. Oh,
banned.
Don't tell the UCI.
Seriously. I actually have a goal this year. I want to see if I can bump up my 5 second power. So this power, I want to see if I can 4 or 5 seconds, how close I can get to. So my current max power, I think, is just under 1500 watts, but I've never really worked on sprinting per se. Like I've never like, okay, this week I'm going to work on this. I've done occasional sprint workouts, but that's it. But I've never worked on it. And I want to see if I can, how close I can get my 5 second power to that 1500. Cause I'm at, I just on those efforts the other day, I did 1200 for 5 seconds, but I want to see if I can get to that. Cause that's like if in crits in particular, cause that's really the only spot where I would ever use sprinting. Like the sort of road races I'm going to win, probably, I don't know, I guess they could be sprinting too, but crits really where it's at. If I'm a smaller rider and I think I'm pretty good at positioning, if I could have a really strong sprint, that could be great. But this is like total contrarian perspective to what you're dealing with here, Keith. And if, granted though, Keith might be doing draft legal try. I don't know. And you might be at like the pointy end of the race and doing that sprinting, sort of stuff, but
you're still draft legal. You're drafting. That's what you should be actually, doing until you get to the run.
You sprint on the run. So
get your 50-meter sprint in. John too, to put that in perspective, people don't understand. If John can do 1500 watts for 5 seconds, you watch NorCal Cycling's videos, he often does not do that at the end of a race. And John doing this fresh versus in a race is different. But that would put him at the top of the P12 if he can be in position, which that's its own thing. But John could totally win NorCal P12 races with a 5 second 1500 watt sprint.
Yeah, 1350 is, I'm looking at my TrainerRoad personal records right now, and 1350 is my all-time record. And this year I did 1280. So
the 1350 though, was that in a sprint practice or was that in a race?
Sprint practice on a mountain bike too. I can put out more power on a mountain bike than I can in a sprint, than I can on a road bike. And I think it's because of the leverage, the gained leverage that you get with wider handlebars. However, it's also a very different technique. And I feel like a fish out of water if I'm good on one or the other. Like it's a totally different deal. So, and I dream of being good enough in a cross country race that I could actually use a sprint, because that does not happen like ever. It's a time trial at my level. And that's like the top of the Cat One level. It's still a time trial where everybody just kind of hits their max at some point during the race. And it usually ends up getting spaced out. So, but anyways, it's just a fun thing. So.
Extra point on that, just to hammer it home. I often hear people who in training sprint so much higher numbers than me, but when it comes to the race, when you're fatigued, those numbers drop off to almost nothing. Oh, you might peak at 1300 and then have a 1100 or 1000. It's completely different. And you need to be able to sprint when you're fatigued after a minute at, I don't know, 600 watts or something. And then you sprint. That's a whole different kind of animal than just let's line up buddies and or friends and let's sprint.
I think this is I looked at this over a year ago, but I think the highest 5 second power I've held for a sprint in a race is less than 1,000 watts, because usually I'm always cooked, right? It's just really, and here's the thing too, like it may be different if your fitness allows you to just comfortably position and just be fine in position, but I really have to fight for that position. It's really hard to get into the position that I need to. So I'm really worked. And that's the cool part, is you don't have to have that huge sprint to be able to win it. So even if you're not like Keith here and just doing triathlon, it's still, you don't have to have a certain bar of entry to be able to win, particularly with sprinting, because so much of that is about positioning. Amber, I don't know if you have anything to add to that, but
no, you guys are nailing it. I agree.
Yeah.
Does the drop ride count?
Yeah, for sure. It's a race simulation. Well,
12:17 for me for a sprint and the drop ride.
That's impressive. Was that in the saddle,
five
Nate?
5 seconds.
So, because that's what my mind went to at first. Sorry.
No, that was out of the saddle.
Okay. Still. And Nate can produce a huge amount of power in the saddle. It's pretty impressive. So,
thank you, Jonathan.
But anyways, 5 second power probably doesn't matter for the majority of us. If we're going to focus our energy, it's all about raising FTP. So then that way we can absorb more blows. They just hurt less and we can carry more speed. And then that's the sort of stuff that wins you races. So,
right. Then you have pressure at the sprint.
For those who are, the way I'm figuring this out really fast is on your personal record chart on the website, if you click on a time, there's this button called view details. And inside of that, there's tabs and you can look at comparative to week or all time. And you can basically, you can scroll down a history of all the PRs that you got. A lot of people don't know about this. So then it makes it easy to see how you've progressed over time and which ones you got your max power on.
It's awesome. I actually just opened that up to look at that. And last year I actually set a new race PR for 5 seconds and that was 1100. So, but and that will also though, it's fair to say that race was relatively easy for me, and Tucker, our past producer, was basically my Sherpa the whole time. So once again, if it was actually like a truly demanding race where I was having to fight for position and do all that stuff, my power would not be there. But it wouldn't really matter. So,
John, I want to Sherpa you for one crit sometime.
That'd be fun.
I just want to last three laps, just put you in position.
That'd be great. And you being a big rider too, like, I don't know. Sorry, I know we're going off the rails here, but whatever. School's out for summer vibes. But with this, like, when I'm next to a big rider like that and I'm trying to fight for position, I just don't even try. Like, you can watch in one of the race videos we have on Race Analysis where I got close to Mike's bikes, their train, at the last lap at the Folsom Criterium from last year. And like, I went to go in and I bounced off of their hip like it was nothing. My shoulder was like at the hip of the rider because they're so big. And I just realized, I was like, there's no point for me to even be able to get into here. It's really intimidating to ride with bigger riders. So if I could have Nate as my Sherpa, the big rider, and then I can just make sure I hold that wheel, that'd be pretty cool. I want to race again.
You need more lead outs. Amber will help the lead out. I'll be a sweeper. I can't do that.
No, yes. We have this whole internal fantasy team that we're like, oh, you'll take over from this lap and this lap.
Yeah.
Live in the same spot of the country, but we've thought about it.
It's like the HTC high road, but it's a composite team around the whole world. So.
If you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
do it.
If you think I have better hair than Jonathan, give it a thumbs up. If not, leave a comment.
My hair is better than his.